for media to show you here from ESWC, so let's go ahead and turn that on. Looking beautiful.
Hello,
ESWC
chat.
Winter.
Yeah. Here
the
we
Clash
go!
Clash Royale Finals, all right!
We see you all, chat. Hello, everybody. Thank you guys for joining us.
Whew.
You guys are beautiful.
Oh, we got some mortar hype.
Oh, yeah.
In the chat. Lupanji equals Nemsensei. Okay.
What's okay. up, Legimate? Legimate, go for it.
Oh, man. Looking at all these other games over at ESWC.
Oh. Do you ever play
It looks League? Like it's so much fun. No, you know, I haven't played like
Me
CSGO
neither.
Or anything like that.
Me
but...
neither. We're just Clash Royale. We're just here.
Exactly. But the hype levels are through the roof right now.
Yeah. Then watching this makes me want to be there.
Oh, man. That would be a lot of fun sometime to get to go
with Paris.
Yeah,
Bonjour.
Go to Paris.
Look at that trophy.
Mm.
Oh, yeah. I can't imagine like winning something like that on stage and you stand up and you're like, yeah!
Hundreds of people cheering for you, if not thousands worldwide
yeah.
watching online, you know.
I'm excited for Clash Royale. It's slowly but surely turning into an e-sport, and it just makes it so fun for us. I mean, you and I have now, this is our third event casting together. Go team.
Go
I
team.
Mean, I just,
Let's do
I
it.
Cannot wait to see what the future brings. I mean, it's just working its way up there, and I'm so excited for the game.
It is, and you know, the developers actually did a question and answer with the community recently on Reddit and on the forums. And one of the big questions that was asked of them is, where do you see Clash Royale going in the future as a competitive esport? And I think that this is it was a really heartening answer. They came back and said, we want to add more features to tournaments, we want to improve them so that the in-game tournament feature is competitive with what we see out there in the big name competitions like ESWC and of course Northern Arena, which we've co-casted together.
And I was excited that they were the ones that put on the crown jewel. They were the ones that invested into it and said, hey, let's put on something, let's make it fun. Doing those goofy challenges, I can't imagine, like having a pie in my face with tennis balls shot at me when I'm trying to play. That's gotta take some skill doing that. But it's fun, it makes it fun and something different, which is kind of goes hand in hand with the game.
That's right, and it was great preparation for being up on stage.
Oh, yeah.
When you have hundreds of people in the audience screaming and yelling and cheering for you, if you don't have any background in at least being able to take a pie to the face while playing Clash Royale, then it's going to be difficult to be able to do that.
Or like hit the ball like Clyde. He's rolling around that metal cage.
Oh man, that looks like so much fun. But how can you get vertigo while you're playing Clash Royale? It's like, rolling all over the place.
Applaudissements pour ceux qui vont nous faire vibrer et commenter ces matchs.
Oh, doesn't the stage look beautiful?
I know. Gosh, watching this just makes me want to be there. I would feel the energy. Look at all the hype in chat. Guys, hype it up with us, please.
Let's go. All right.
What time is it in D.C.? It's
8:07
a.m.
Bright and early here. The stream, the finals here of ESWC. Competition, yeah, and they're telling us now that the bronze match that we're just about to watch is going to be between Malcaide and Ouahleouff. Ouahleouff.
Somebody's going to have to tell us how to pronounce that. Where are my French people at?
Yeah, where are they at? Where are the French
English speakers? Ouch.
Shatters.
I took my high school college French is not helping me.
Not at all. Oh, worthless. You know, we have two different countries being represented here. We have a French representative and a Spanish representative. It's well reflected in the attendance at the event. We hear that there's a lot of hype in both of those communities.
Oh, yeah. We got Alvaro. He's casting for all of our Spanish speakers. Go, Alvaro. He's such a huge name in the community. And I know we got Trimax. He's casting in German.
Absolutely.
We're international with Clash Royale, which is one of the fun things. I mean, that's the thing that I'm sure you can attest to as well. I love about streaming is I get to talk Très bien.
Et ben on va installer dans quelques instants. Je vous laisse vous installer. Allez-y. On va regarder d'ailleurs le tableau pour que vous puissiez bien voir où est-ce qu'on est dans ce tournoi.
One of my friends from actually casting was at this event, Saint-Or 9.
Oh,
and I had my fingers crossed. I was hoping he's going to get to the finals. Not this time, but he did very, very well.
I did see him on the bracket, and I thought of you because I know you guys are friends.
C'est ça qu'on va vivre dans quelques instants.
You can see the bracket here.
There we go.
We're covering it up.
Troisième place.
Get off of it. But yeah, the top eight players all had to beat hundreds of opponents to be able to get through the qualifier stages through the live and online events. But here we have Malcaide stepping up.
There we go.
Representing Mouklash.
Venez à côté de moi juste avant de démarrer. Come with me.
Here we go.
Un petit mot rapidement.
Taking the stage here.
Jeremy, j'imagine que t'es déjà très heureux d'arriver aussi loin dans le tournoi. Et tu
retrouves quelqu'un. They're not looking at each other.
They're like in the zone.
They're just like laser focused straight ahead.
Oh my gosh. They are in the zone. I'd be sweating up there, I think.
Oh man, absolutely. It could be 30 degrees Fahrenheit and it could be freezing there and they would be sweating, you know? All the competitive juices flowing and you know, all the heat from the competition.
Yeah, I'm ready with some new decks and
going to get one of those. Oh, they're speaking in English. Go team!
Go team! Hey, that's a little bit of a thing.
Hey, thanks very much to Flash Royale for giving us some shoutouts.
Shoutouts, Superstar! We love you guys so much.
We love you. Thanks for making the game and for supporting it so well.
Yes.
Okay,
so much love.
Bonjour à tous, bonjour à toutes les personnes.
All right, so we're gearing up. We've got the two on stage for our bronze match here. What's up, chat? We see all of you guys. Thank you so much for joining us. I love all the hype in chat that you guys have. Dropping all the flames in there. Hi, guys.
On fire right now. Man. BBXH. We talked a little bit about some of the decks that we expect to see, some of the different competitive elements that are being brought to bear here, the different communities that are supporting these players. Has there been anything on your radar in the past few weeks looking forward to this event? Outside of, necessarily in-game gameplay, maybe anyone in the community that you've been talking to about ESWC or just anything that's been on your mind about the event?
I mean, I guess the main thing is I would say I'm closest to Surgical Goblin, so he's been the one that I've chatted with, and I've gotten a chance to really sit down with him and kind of pick his brain about the game and learn a little bit about the way he goes into the game mentally, what he kind of looks for as he's playing the match, and how he, like you were saying, you've got to learn to adapt to your player, and that's when you're able to play well, and that's what he does. He plays based on what they're playing, and he has just his little different methods, which has been pretty neat to watch, so I think
certainly.
He's been the one that's got me most excited. All right, so let's switch over. It looks like we've got the first match going.
I think we do.
Are you guys ready?
Oh,
oh, we gotta pull up the...
There it is. Hey. The first match is now underway. The bronze match between Malcaide and Ouahleouff.
I love that he has a heart in his name.
Yeah, right? Feeling the love here. Ooh, nice little ice cream down there. Malcaide bleeds a little bit of elixir away. But no big commitment from either brother. Wow, the rocket! Oh yeah, hits the Electro Wizard. Big damage on the tower there.
I love that Malcaide's rocking some of the newer cards that have come out recently. He's got the Electro Wizard in there. He's got the Dark Goblin in there. It's fun to see something different and new.
Yeah, Dark Goblin just recently came out of the game, but it's been hitting pretty hard.
Players
kind of underestimated it, I think, but it has been making a big impact right now.
Nice push. Look at that Miner hits the tower while he's got the other push coming in there.
Ooh, nice placement on that Electro Wizard, hits all the targets, preventing a little bit more damage from coming in. Malcaide taking some big hits at the beginning of this match.
Yeah, and he hasn't done too much damage to Ouahleouff's towers yet, maybe just about 200 damage to that left side tower. That is it so far.
That's right, and check out the cards that Ouahleouff is playing here. Mostly just commons and rares. We do see a Miner in there, but very, basic vanilla, high value, easy to use cards.
I think it's nice for our viewers, something relatable, because not everybody's got all the legendaries out there, so it's kind of helpful for them to see some of the greater players using those cards.
Absolutely right. Oh, there goes the log, though.
Legendary number two.
There it is. One of the most popular cards in the game right now.
I love the log.
Oh, man. So extremely good. High value against those small ground-based pushes. Easy 2-for-3 trade against the Dark Goblin there. Well done to Ouahleouff.
So he's just chipping away with his miner on Malcaide's tower there. That's what's getting most of his damage so far.
That's true. They're both playing relatively conservative, kind of control decks, not really going for a big beatdown assault.
Playing a little bit reactive to start here, but Ouahleouff is going for that push as soon as he sees opportunities to do so.
That's right.
Ooh,
kind of consistent chip damage with the miner and just spells rolling into this tower.
Yes.
Ouahleouff did take a pretty nasty hit there. Down to 1478, but still ahead overall. Malcaide's at 1329. Looks like Malcaide is running a little bit low on elixir, and this might be the time for Ouahleouff to make a big push happen here. Knight, Musketeer, Miner going in for a big hit here.
Very nice. Oh, nice. Very nice. So I see both of them. We're still waiting on that last card.
That's right. Haven't seen all of them yet. Malcaide, actually, interestingly, is playing the Valkyrie. We haven't seen a whole lot of her recently.
Yeah, especially because Executioner has come out. He's very similar, except that he hits air as well.
And he's got that beautiful range for just one more elixir.
He's so nice. We got both of them down to triple digits now. Nice arrow.
Oh, here comes the rocket! It's out!
That's it.
Ouahleouff takes the first game of this series. Well
done. Very nice. Now, I have to say, in some of the battles leading up to today, we saw a lot of rockets for the win, which is an interesting thing. I mean, I have a feeling after this tournament, we're going to be seeing a lot more rockets in people's decks that they're using.
That's right. You know, Rocket's been one of my favorite cards. It's the clan emblem for Reddit Alpha. That's the clan
that's
I read.
True.
So
that
shout
is
out
true.
To those guys. But very excited to see some very smart defensive gameplay here. I expect to see some different, you know, deck diversity as we progress through the matches here. But two very careful conservative game decks being used there, and Ouahleouff taking the edge off in that one, you know, with that big push at the end, dropping the rocket. It's guaranteed damage, big six elixir investment, but you can see the decks on screen there.
Yep.
Now the last card from each of them. Yeah, it looks like Malcaide was playing the Inferno Tower. Didn't get a whole lot. They were both playing Inferno Tower, in fact.
True.
Didn't really get
an opportunity to play them. Not really necessary. With a minor deck, I mean, it's not going to, unless you place it next to your tower, not going to do too much for you. But having Inferno Tower is such a great thing to have in case your opponent is playing one of those big tanks, something like Golem, Lava Hound. It's a lifesaver sometimes to have that Inferno Tower in your deck.
That's right. Oh, man. It doesn't see a whole lot of play, but I think it's safe to have one card in your deck that, you know, is just kind of there as the clutch defense against something that you're really worried about. Arrows can be that card sometimes if you're really worried about zap bait decks, you know, overwhelming you with, you know, minion horde and, you know, tons of goblins and things like that. It looks like we've got the second game in the series ready to go now between Malcaide and Ouahleouff.
Dropping the good luck, the thumbs up. Oh, do you have your thumbs up?
I do, Where's it at?
There it is.
Hey! Here, I got one for you
thanks.
Too.
That's me laughing.
I've got the thumbs and the angry king. You've got the laughing and sad king. Oh, no. Sad for poor Malcaide. Lost the first match, but he's going to be coming back with a vengeance here.
Yes. Let's see if they're using the same deck. So
Graveyard from Ouahleouff.
Very nice. I knew we were going to see some graveyards. Like, graveyards have been out and about a lot lately. We've seen a lot of graveyards in the meta right now.
Perfect defense from Malcaide, though. Yes. He took some chip damage from the poison, but I don't even know if a single skeleton got to hit the tower there.
You know, I've been seeing a lot of people, now that poison's got a little bit of a buff, using poison as defense against graveyard now.
That's true, and poison works wonders. It can one-shot skeletons now, which means that you don't really even have to worry about them hitting the tower. You just plop that down a second or two after they deploy the graveyard, and you're good to go.
Yep. All right, so we got Knight crossing the bridge here, Musketeer to defend it from Malcaide. And she shuts him down. You go, girl.
Girl
Shut
power.
It down. Girl power.
Malcaide ahead now in this matchup. He's going to add some skeletons onto this Musketeer push to give her a little bit more tanking.
Yep.
Nicely done. Forced an Electra Wizard out of Ouahleouff. A 4-for-5 trade is no, bad play there, especially when you're rocking on the defense.
Got a bowler now. First bowler
Big
of the game.
Big ol' bowler. Perfect drop on the minions. Knew exactly where they were
going
to go.
Yep.
Well
done. Knew exactly where it was going. Sometimes I just almost fell off my chair.
Oh, no.
That's one of the best things that you can do when you're playing against a miner is if you can predict where they're going to drop the miner and you can predict it accurately, it can really set you ahead
A lot of skeletons building up in this tower right now. Oh, that poor knight dropped.
Wow. Lots of damage from that push, though.
Gave his life to defend that tower.
Yes.
Down to 1573, but...
his life was not in vain.
No, not at all.
All right, so it looks like both of them building elixir. Knight from both, from both players right now.
That's
same
right.
thing, Musketeer from Malcaide to defend this knight.
Ouahleouff adding on to the push. Wow, I don't know.
An aggressive Inferno Tower there from Malcaide.
Yeah, certainly. It is definitely going to shut this push down.
Yes.
And I don't... Oh, wow, we got minions added onto that bowler at the very last second.
Bowler.
I was worried about the bowler, but Ouahleouff added on just what he needed to do. And here comes the graveyard attack
again.
Now.
Perfect play. He's got the bowler, his tank right at the river, and then as soon as that tank is at the river, he drops the
graveyard.
Oh,
missed with the log. Bowler knocked it back, and Ouahleouff giving the cry face. Sad. Just a few tears there. Malcaide responds with a rocket.
Oh,
big attack coming in to support this miner, and this game is tied up now. 1,300 for both players. They're actually within one hit point of each other. Look at that.
Oh my gosh, you're right.
Big attack coming in from Ouahleouff now.
Look at that perfect
8 seconds
play.
Left. This push could end the game.
He's got the bowler, he's got the knight, and he's got that graveyard on there. Doesn't get much better than that when you've got something tanky on the river to tank the damage while your graveyard hits.
Very nice defense from Malcaide, though. Flawless stopping power with that knight.
Look at that, once again, dropping the bowler.
The
no
rocket
mercy.
Cycle from Malcaide. He's going for the kill.
Yes,
can't
he is.
Quite get there with another rocket and log, though. He's definitely going to have to do another push. And this is the last push
here it goes.
That Ouahleouff has before the game is going to be shut out by spells. Malcaide has to defend with the log now
that.
To shut some of these
here
skeletons down.
Is
but I think Ouahleouff's got it. Skeletons on the tower. And there it goes.
Well
done, Ouahleouff. Had one last push to make it happen and secures the win.
Very nice. Well,
oh, man.
It looked like Malcaide was getting ready to rocket him to death there. And that's I think he realized that's what I'm going to have to do in this match. But he realized it just a little bit too late in the match to be able to bring it back.
Yeah, just couldn't get that last rocket on the tower. Malcaide, didn't start the rocket cycle until relatively late in the game. Wanted to make sure... that he was playing conservatively enough to not, suffer a big push. Because Graveyard is really threatening. If you don't have the perfect response to it, it can deal a lot of damage. And the fact that there's a little bit of, randomness to where the skeletons spawn also adds to the confusion for a defender oftentimes. Makes it very difficult to, push it back. Malcaide did a great job, but just a little bit off there. Didn't manage, to keep the tower up just long enough to be able to get the rocket cycle in.
That was close. I mean, they were pretty even, like you mentioned. They were literally within one HP point of each other at one point in that match. And I think that's what they're really bringing to the table today. These are pretty evenly matched battles that we're seeing. It really is going to be the best of the best whoever takes the title today.
Definitely. Alki X says, hello from Poland. How you doing, Alki? Thanks for stopping by in chat. Hot, 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 hot. Man, the heat is on right now. Yeah, these are nice little signs, but they double as wonderful fans.
Oh my goodness. We see everybody in chat. Hello, everybody in chat. This is Woody. I am BBXH, and we're casting for you guys today the ESWC tournament. We are your English casters officially, and happy to have all of you guys here. Tell both of us in chat, who are you rooting for today? Who do you think is going to take the title? Spam it in chat so we can see who you think is going to win.
Let us know. Malcaide made a great comeback to get to the bronze match here today. He was actually down 2-1 against his clanmate, but made the reverse sweep happen. So Malcaide is no stranger to making the comeback. Let's see how this next match goes.
All right, so we're seeing the same pushes here. We've got Malcaide sticking with the same deck. Looks like Knight's still there, Musky's still there. And we're still, I think, Miner from both of them. Yep. Miner from both
this
players.
This is a very nice push here, though. We see Knight, Miner, Skellies, and the Musketeer going out. Malcaide committed a big amount of elixir to this push. But check out the deployment on that Knight.
Well done.
From Ouahleouff. Made sure to knock the Musketeer off the tower. Malcaide actually gets the better end of that trade there.
I have to say, Musketeer is such a good card. If you drop her behind something, she can just sit there and get so much value, so much damage, just sitting behind another card, something tanky, even something not expensive like a knight. All right, Miner
Indeed.
Coming in from Ouahleouff again, slowly but surely chipping away at Malcaide's tower there. Oh,
there's
rocket.
The rocket!
For
the rocket
Musky.
Is real!
The rocket is real.
Oh, man. Skelly's even getting a few chips off on that tower. Malcaide has actually switched. He's going to be playing Poison as his big support card here. I'm so excited to see Rocket, though. You asked me what cards I wanted to see. I said Mortar, but man, Rocket would have been a close second.
It's in it this turn. We've seen a lot in the semifinals leading up to today. Like I said, a lot of Rockets for the wind at the end of matches.
That's right. When your opponent and you both have perfect defensive gameplay, it's that guaranteed spell damage that can be absolutely critical.
You cannot stop it.
No, there's no way to stop it. Can't stop the rock. Oh.
All right, man. Nice log. A lot
Knight
of value.
And Musketeer from both players. Oh, heavy and defensive Inferno from Malcaide.
I notice a lot of the great players, they place their towers like that right at the river.
It kind of catches you off guard, because a lot of times you expect that defensive tower to be set up on the back end. Yeah, in the middle. And so when it starts burning away into your troops, it can really distract and, you know, shut the push down. Expect a knight here from Malcaide to block. Oh, no, he's got skeletons out front instead.
Poison coming in, hitting Leo's tower and musketeer at the same time. Nice. Nice placement of that poison there from Malcaide.
Pulling far ahead now. Yes. 800 damage ahead
he's
of his opponent
hard.
With only 30 seconds left.
Ooh,
here comes the big
rockets.
Attack from Ouahleouff. Rocket
nice
hits the tower,
rockets.
And now they're both into
nice
triple digits.
Rockets. Those minions, same thing, minions taking out that miner, but this is a close game here. I mean, they've got 24 seconds left in the match here.
That's right. Malcaide definitely wants to get the 1-0 here. Mm-hmm. Just defending a little bit longer and getting one more poison onto the tower will do it. Heavy defense is an Inferno Tower Musketeer.
Oh, here comes in the miner. Is
the
it
going to
take it? He knows that he's just,
check out that ice barrier! It shuts it down!
Oh,
the miner from Ouahleouff does not connect!
Not gonna do it. Four,
the
three,
good game, well played!
Two, one.
It's over! Malcaide gets a win!
Wow, what an ending to that match. I cannot believe that. That was super close. And I mean, he was pushing. Ouahleouff was pushing with that. He dropped the rocket, he dropped the log, but it wasn't quite enough to do it.
Beautifully done. Malcaide set up an impregnable defense. Ice Spirit and Skeletons out on the back end made sure to block the miners from doing too much damage. Very, very well done by Malcaide there.
Yes.
Oops, that was the match previous.
Yeah, I want to look
at... Oh, you want to see it? Okay, fair enough.
Yeah, let's look at all the... All right, so this is the first match. You see Ouahleouff took the one crown for the win there.
Miners in both decks.
Yep. Second one, Ouahleouff again. A little bit of a variety in the deck there. He switched to the graveyard. All right, and our... Oops.
Oh, we were spectating. Yeah,
they
requested a match. I think this is a recording. So they requested a match. Here it is. There's
there
the live match. Game number 4 in this series. Ouahleouff up 2-1 over Malcaide.
Yes. Here we go. Both just building elixir now. There we go. First card drop by Ouahleouff. The ice golem there. Tanks from both players to start. Tanks in the back.
Little mini tanks. Ouahleouff adds on a musketeer. Ooh, nice
still
poison, though.
Still rocking the poison.
Yeah. And that poison will be able to kill the musketeer. She's planted in place because she's targeted onto the knight. Poison ticks her down.
Shuts it
down,
though.
Yeah. Nice little chip damage onto the tower.
Ouahleouff spent his minions, which is a little bit risky, I feel like, because he knows that Malcaide's been rocking that miner all the time, and that's been his main defense against Malcaide's miner. Nice fireball.
Well done. Ouahleouff is actually rocking the fireball, not able to kill the musketeer. So Malcaide might have a little bit of an edge up if he's able to control the damage from this poison. You know, poison got a nice buff recently.
Yes.
The DPS increased massively, up over 20%. And so it did lose 2 seconds on its total duration, but it's a lot easier to kill those glass cannon type troops like musketeer when you're able to keep them in the range of that poison.
And like we talked about before, it's now such a solid defense against the graveyard where you can't fireball a poison. It's just there. It's going to do the damage no matter what.
It will. LLS Master 01 said, I have met Malcaide in real life. No joke. That's awesome.
Nice.
Meeting these huge big name players is always a ton of fun.
Yeah, it is a lot of fun.
Ouahleouff on the back end, Barb Hutt.
Something different. Yeah. We've seen a lot of Barb Hutts in the semifinals a little bit. That was something that we saw Surgical Goblin playing, and he won his match with a Barb Hutt.
He did, and it's one of those unexpected cards.
Yeah,
you don't see a whole lot
is.
Of Barb Hutt in gameplay.
Nice.
Getting a chance to check out
Musketeer and making a name for herself today. We're seeing her in both decks.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, nice push. Perfectly played by Ouahleouff. Got the... ice golem across the river and the graveyard drops. Nice fireball also.
Great fireball. Didn't keep Ouahleouff's own musketeer alive. And this graveyard got some nice chip damage. More in toward the end than at the beginning.
Malcaide
coming in for the counterattack. Miner right onto the tower. Not even going.
With that poison, though, he's great value for his poison. He's hitting the barbs, hitting the hut, and hitting the tower, all with that one poison.
Absolutely, and if he just keeps up that constant chip damage, he will get that tower down, no doubt, within the next 30 seconds. It's just the threat of a big graveyard attack that really has Malcaide having to play defense. And here it comes. Yes. Here's one of them. This might actually be a little bit premature from Ouahleouff. Might have wanted to wait until the barbarians and musketeer could get
in
range.
Look at this push, though. He's Malcaide doing a great job defending this match. Really, I mean, you see, Ouahleouff with his push going down. You're like, what is he gonna do? And he successfully shuts it down.
And with skeletons and ice spirit, the two cheapest cards in the game, has managed to keep a lot of these big attacks off. We're in sudden death time now, though. The tower goes down. Graveyard on the back end.
Wow.
I didn't think that Ouahleouff would be able to get a second graveyard attack in there, but
he did.
Fantastic cycle.
Very nice.
And just 100 hit points left on his left side tower. Barely managed to keep it up, but that's all you need.
Yes.
And that's 3-1 for Ouahleouff.
There you have it. Very
well
nice done.
Let's switch that overlay back to see the players once again. See them
there
on, here we are. We're hovering right above them. About to get the interview, the results have been finalized. A 3-1 victory for Ouahleouff gives him the bronze.
Yes, it does. Very nice. He's walking away with that victory at least today. Well played there. Like you said, he got that second graveyard play in at the end there, and that's really what won the match for them. But that was a close match, just like the match we watched before, where you're just biting your nails at the end there. And, you know, it could be either player's game there. You never know what could happen in this game, and you never give up.
Very well could have. You know, just one more poison or a couple more taps from the miner would have taken that tower down. And they time the construction of their deck so precisely to try to defend just enough to be able to drop a tower right before overtime starts. And, Ouahleouff did it perfectly there. Just 100 hit points is the same as, 2,000 hit points as long as you've taken out one of your opponent's towers. And that big graveyard push at the end won him the match. I thought it was a little bit too aggressive, but you got to be able to push hard, and it's one of the key design principles of Clash Royale, offense over defense.
Yes.
If you can get, the troops directly onto the tower, that's all you gotta do.
Yep, you gotta do both then. You have to know when's the right time for me to push more offensively versus defensively, and knowing those times are what are going to win you these matches.
Certainly.
Wow, I can't imagine how they're feeling. I mean, my heart would be pounding if I were up there. I mean, like I said, I did a tournament the other day just sitting here at home by myself, and I was like shaking a little bit. And then eventually, I can't imagine that being on stage like that. And I mean, you're in front of all these people, and you know that there are thousands and thousands of people watching you today, and lots of pressure for both players, but they handle themselves well.
You know, we saw about 50 spectators in that match itself,
but
even more out in the wide world, broadcasting in German, French, Spanish, English here. There are thousands of players watching these games, and this is probably the biggest audience that they've ever had leading up to this point.
And like we said, I mean, Clash Royale is slowly but surely making a name. So there we go. We got our next players. We see Surgical up there. What's up? Rocking the Hammers jersey. Very, very nice.
Surgical.
And then we got Nemsensei.
And Nemsenpai. Nemsensei. Is that it?
Senpai.
Yeah, Nemsensei.
As a Twitcher, we just naturally want to say Senpai.
Yes. I mean,
Senpai.
Yes, indeed. Representatives from the Netherlands and France now up here on the big stage.
Wow.
Hammers Esports represented by Surgical Goblin.
Yep.
The Netherlands player. And Nemsensei from France defending his homeland.
Yes.
The title
for
Vitality, Team Vitality.
Wow. Yeah, no pressure on Nemsensei. Rocking his country.
Not
there.
At all. Yeah.
No big deal.
You're going to let this Dutch invader come and take the gold? From the French? I don't know.
Surgical is such a... Because, like I said, he's the one player out of these that I have actually spoken to one-on-one, and he's such a nice guy. And, I mean, he's such a good player. You can't help but have, a little love in your heart for him. But, I mean, these other players, a lot of them are newer to the scene, as you mentioned before, but they're here. They're making a name for themselves, and that's pretty impressive to say.
They are indeed. And, yeah, man, making a top finish in the biggest event in the world is certainly going to get your name out there. People had already heard of Surgical Goblin, and the name recognition for Nemsensei has been building, but a number one finish would definitely propel him into the hearts and minds of Clashers worldwide.
Absolutely. I mean, or even those that maybe don't even come in first, but those that are here today, they're competing, they're in the tops of these matches. They are, like you said, they're making names for themselves, and it's pretty impressive because, like we mentioned before, I mean, it's slowly but surely turning into an e-sport, and we end up with our favorite players that we watch, just like regular sports, but e-sports, of course. All right, so it looks like they have put the friendly matches up. All right.
It's just about ready to start.
Switch us over to ESCW2.
Leave it at full screen.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
Coming up soon, and the players are just about to get underway. We'll see this match starting very soon. Who's going to win the grand final? Thanks very much for that tweet from Clash Royale.
Woohoo!
Dragging some you know, sleepy Americans out of bed.
Yeah.
Hopefully they come see
wake up, guys.
Things live here. And shout out to everyone in the English-speaking
there
world who's
go.
Tuned in. Surgical, he's right on top of us. There
nice
he is,
Surgical.
Right there. He's going to be playing against Nemsensei from France.
Yes.
Give it up for these guys in chat.
Woo!
Woohoo! Over 5K trophies.
There we go.
Personal best for both of these guys. But
both
Nemsensei, more than twice as many wins, has been playing Clash Royale a lot. You know, I guess Surgical Goblin has been playing a lot more in tournaments and, you know, friendly battles.
Yes, he does.
Nemsensei grinding the ladder to great effect. Let's see. They're both sitting at 10 elixir. Man,
yeah.
Neither one of them is going to make it.
They're waiting.
There goes Nemsensei finally dropping knight on the left side.
Lots of knights today.
Lots of knights. Yeah, you know, a lot of people considered it an underpowered card. Hadn't seen a whole lot of it in competitive gameplay, but it is definitely making a comeback onto the scene.
Yeah, I'm interested to see now that this tournament has gone on, if afterwards we're going to see a lot more
I definitely expect
knights.
For us
Same.
To.
Ooh, a bowler.
Great
nice bowler.
Helping
Ooh.
To compensate a little bit for the missed log there. I think Surgical Goblin was hoping
oh,
to...
Battle Ram!
Oh my god! Man, we've seen plenty of logs. We haven't seen them carried by barbarians very much, have we?
I love that. We see one of the brand new cards from Surgical Goblin. If
That's
anybody
right.
can play it, it's him. And we've got the Executioner now.
Executioner.
I love it. I love it.
You know, Nem ignored that miner on the back end, though. Brought his tower down in 1922.
That battle ram is something that you cannot ignore. The biggest thing is that if that thing hits your tower, that is a lot of damage from
it. Oh, a ton. And perfect placement from Nen there. That
nice.
Ice Spirit did take one little swing from the Executioner, but before the axe could come back and finish it off, it hopped on and got the little freeze on there.
Nice log. Valuable. Helped take out that Electro Wizard and hit Nemsensei's tower as well.
Surge does have a healthy lead, though.
Yes, he does.
Nice little elixir advantage and tower damage advantage, especially
Ooh,
with that lightning in there.
Trading lightning. Lightning and rocket, both risky cards. I mean, they're 6 elixir, and it's something that can really set you ahead in the game or can set you behind elixir, so.
That's right, but that's
Ooh,
the best feeling for big, explosive, competitive gameplay.
Yes, it is. Oh, a tornado!
A
high risk,
high reward.
Nicely done with that tornado.
Excellent
Beautiful
play, yeah.
Play.
You know, tornado's been played a lot with Executioner, but we're seeing it also used alongside Boulder here in Surge's deck. But the Royal Giant from Nemsensei, big old beatdown. Last second, didn't even expect that, but Furnace Royal Giant, a dominant archetype.
But Surgical taking that opportunity while he knows that Nemsensei has just dropped a bunch of elixir, so he sends in that miner to do some chip damage on his tower.
Wow, a lightning on just a lone knight there.
Oh, another
Big
one.
Elixir investment for Surge to have to defend against a Royal Giant coming in now.
Yes.
No buildings in Surge's deck to try to distract the Royal Giant.
But he's got that lightning. Let's see if he uses it on this.
Oh, probably not. That
to.
Would be a big elixir investment to you know, take out the remainder of that push. He wants to use the lightning on the tower for sure. Any chance he's going to get. We're in overtime now, so it's the next tower
nice
that's
going
to win
Miner
the game.
Miner going into the tower.
Tornado keeps the minions off that miner, but not quite within range of a lightning. Surge has got to defend one more
nice,
time.
Nice, nice, nice. Look at that. The Executioner hitting all of them. Oh,
oh my god, the lightning goes off! The log is gonna do it! Nemsensei
oh
takes
God.
The first win!
Wow.
Oh, explosive gameplay at the end. Surge just had one more defense there, but no buildings in his deck to distract that Royal Giant, and the perfect timing of lightning from Nemsensei distracted by stunning the defensive units and the tower. Got a lot of damage in there. He put it all on the line, and he took the win.
Surgical... He is not one to usually play a meta deck. He's not afraid to play an unorthodox deck, which we just saw. I mean, we saw Battle Ram in there, we saw Tornado, a lot of things that we don't normally see, which, as I mentioned before, in the semifinals, he played a P.E.K.K.A. 3 Musketeer deck. That is a high-risk, high-reward deck, and Sometimes it pays off, sometimes it doesn't. That's the risk you take, but I think that's one of the things about Surgical that makes him so entertaining to watch, is that he's not afraid to try those, and he's not afraid to bring it on. So that
and
was a close
really,
match, though.
You know, throws his opponents off balance. When you don't expect a battle ram of all cards
like,
to be played, when one is coming at you, what do?
Yeah, where did that come from?
Yeah.
So all right, that was only the first match. So we still have some other matches to go here, so no worries. I'm interested to see if Surgical is probably going, my guess, he will probably do a deck change. I wonder if Nemsensei will do a deck change as well, or if he's going to keep it the same.
Oh, I would definitely expect them to be switching it up. The surprise factor is huge.
That's true.
In these last few matches, being able to build decks that are, you know, different with regards to their win condition and have, you know, a card that you hold in the back end and throw at the last second, like the Royal Giant in that last match. With the surprise factor is what you need to get a win in these top competitive events.
Absolutely, and we see a lot of the players that have been, they save Rocket until the end to surprise their opponent as well, so we'll be interested to see if that happens at all this match. Here we go! Match number two. So yeah, Nemsensei with a one win so far for the first match. Starting the same way. Ooh, we got a giant in the back from Nemsensei. Oh!
Giant in the back on the left.
Look at that! Royal Giant from Surgical this time.
Switching it up. Surgy's going to go for the big gold dude this time.
Classic push the Royal Giant with those minions. Hard
down
to defend.
1739. That's a pretty good connection.
Good.
He's got to defend against this big old giant push coming in, though. Is Surge going to have a building on the back end? Oh my god! Graveyard!
Graveyard Giant.
A big push, but very nice log from Surge. Blocks the skellies from reaching the tower and manages to push
Look
the giant
at that
off.
Defense. What a defense from Surgical Goblin. That. Electro Wizard and the Knight just shut down that graveyard.
Very well
giant.
Done. Only I think that was only two swings from skeletons onto the tower.
Yep.
Surge got a nice little counter push there, forced a fireball out of Nemsensei, and just continues to pummel the right side.
Surgical played very well there. He saw the giant coming in. He forced him to defend his push with that Royal Giant. He dropped that Royal Giant right away because he knew that he didn't want Nemsensei to build up a push. Something was coming with that giant.
That's right. Now, Nemsensei's actually made a very interesting choice here. He's soaking a lot of the Fire Spirits over on the right, instead choosing to pump up to try to get the Elixir advantage. I guess he has figured that he can take a little bit of that damage without having to worry too much, instead trying to counter push for an even bigger assault.
You got to do that. With those tanky decks, you've got to be willing to take some damage in order to build your push.
That's right.
Wow, we got the mini P.E.K.K.A. tucked behind that giant there.
And the giant is pushing the Royal Giant off the tower.
Oh my gosh. Nice log from Surgical.
Big assault coming in, but
the
log
tower.
Rolling through everything.
Yes.
I don't even know if Nim's going to get a counterattack here. No damage on tower yet.
Shut down by Surgical. Nice defense from him.
And Nem is just basically conceding the right side at this point. He knows that he's going to lose it, so he pumps up again.
Valuable lightning from Surgical. He hits that left side tower and both elixir collectors that Nemsensei had set down. I guess Nemsensei was not expecting him to be rocking the lightning there.
Not at all. The last big push from Nemsensei coming in on the right side. Minions and Electro Wiz doing a ton of damage to that ground push.
Look at the Mini P.E.K.K.A. coming
here
in.
Here she
mini
comes,
P.E.K.K.A.
though.
Oh, Surgical sees that Mini P.E.K.K.A.
So last second. Keeps it off the tower. You know, the buff to the hit points of the Electro Wizard was what kept it alive right there.
Yes.
Used to be that a Mini P.E.K.K.A. was able to one-shot it, but just a little bit of health left, and it's doing a great job defending against this big old giant push. Lightning is all Surge needs to close out this second match.
He drops the good game there. Here comes
Super
the
combat!
In the French.
Surgical Goblin ties the series 1-1.
Surgical for the win. So we are tied now. Nemsensei with one, Surgical with one. Like I said, these are going to be good matches. They are going to be close. We have phenomenal players competing today. I'm excited to see who takes this.
Yeah, me too.
I gotta fan myself off here.
Cool off, BBXH. Yeah. There's only so much time until game three. It's already up and requested.
Yep.
Surgical and Nemsensei. I know you're rooting for Surgical, aren't you?
Secretly, deep down inside.
Deep down inside.
I won't say it, but I might be.
Ham fam is
blink once if you're rooting for your ham fam.
Blink once.
Look at this trophy here.
Oh, beautiful. This is what they're fighting over right now.
I want that.
Number one. There can only be one. The Highlander takes the trophy at the end.
Yep.
All of their vanquished foes.
Yes.
Get to try again next time.
Match has started. We'll wait for them to switch it over because it has begun.
Very soon. just about to come up.
I'm so excited. I can't wait to see what happens.
Right? What decks are they going to be playing?
Yeah, with? That's what I was just going to say. What are they going to play? Same? The different?
Eyes of the entire Clash world are on these guys right now.
Yes.
Trying to figure out the key card combinations.
Ooh, it looks like Surgical's not going back to his crazy deck there. We'll call it was Battle Ram Tornado. He's got the furnace in there again.
Might be running the same.
Oh, look at Nemsensei! He's got the Battle Ram! Nemsensei Rocket Battle Ram this time. They're oh my gosh!
Yeah, very interesting. You know, we haven't seen a whole lot of Battle Ram competitively.
No, we have not.
And yeah, really cheap three elixir cards like Knight and Minions can take it down.
Yes, Mini Pekka even.
Surge moving in for a counterattack on the left side now, not choosing to use the Fire Spirits from that Furnace to support the push. Instead, he's just going to hit hard with that Royal Giant.
He connected right away to that tower.
And hit hard, he did. Almost 1,000 points of damage from that one push.
Graveyard coming in. Log, look at that value log hitting all of those cards. Knight, Graveyard, Battle Ram.
Archers moving in to support.
Very nice. Look at that placement of that Electro Wizard. Beautiful.
Excellently done. Surge does take a big hit there, down to 1663. Nem almost ties it up. He's a little bit behind an Elixir. He's got to defend against this minion push here. Does take a couple swings on the tower from one that he missed the distraction with the Knight there.
Surgical making sure he's got that Furnace out front just for that solid, secure defense the whole time while he's creating that push with the Royal Giant.
Absolutely. The player from the Netherlands here has switched to the left side. He had a little bit of chip damage going in with the Furnace on the right, but he's switching it to the left. Both players going to push the left side now. I gotta say, I think that the advantage here might be for Surgical Goblin. He's playing a very heavy, big old beatdown deck.
Yep.
It's hard to drill through a Royal Giant without taking at least some damage on the tower.
Yes. Unless you've got some kind of tower defense, you're guaranteed going to at least take some damage.
A little early on the Knight drop there, the tower has not engaged.
But look at this counter push. Nice fireball from Nemsensei.
Well,
I almost said Nemsenpai.
we're both missing it up there. Yeah, perfect cannon drop though.
Yes,
didn't
very
take any damage on the tower from that Royal Giant.
Like we were talking about before, placing those towers at the river really seems to be effective gameplay.
That's right. Nem reaches 10, and he's going to throw an Executioner down there. But the Lightning comes out for Surge, the last card in his deck. Deals a ton of damage
to
the Executioner.
Look at this
Battle
Ram.
Wow, switching to the right. I wonder why Nemsensei did that right side switch.
Maybe he's realizing because his left side tower is so low that he doesn't want Surgical to build up that counter push on the left-hand side.
Yeah, could be. I think you're onto something.
Start from scratch.
It's hard to start from scratch, though, when you've already done 900 damage at the left side.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. That's a risky move, for sure.
Cannon does shut those Fire Spirits down, though.
Oh, here comes a Graveyard once again.
And then continues to apply pressure on the right.
What's Surgical going to drop? Ooh, he does that pre-fireball just in case.
Ooh,
but Surgical
didn't
waits.
Hit anything, though.
Very nice.
But great hit. I mean, he's brought that right side tower down to 1272, and he's now ahead over there. I don't think this cannon's going to be able to do very much against the Royal Giant.
Cannon.
It does soak one hit.
He's got another cannon out there.
But Nemsensei isn't able to soak hardly any damage, down into triple digits already.
Ooh.
Two shots from that Royal Giant is absolutely devastating.
And he's got to be careful. He knows that Surgical has that Lightning in there. Nice
Indeed.
Fireball.
Only two Lightnings, and Nemsensei's going to lose that left side. He's got to defend hard on the left while simultaneously making this right side push.
You got to focus on both sides now.
And splitting up your troops is not the easiest thing to do.
I don't think he has a cannon.
This could be a base race. He's going in for the graveyard.
Here we go.
Oh, but not quickly enough.
That
Royal Giant just dominating.
Yes.
They tried. You know, Nemsensei tried to get the graveyard to hit faster than the Royal Giant, but with the Royal Giant already on the tower and the graveyard taking a few seconds to heat up, just wasn't able to get the damage.
Those are the batches when I'm playing, and it comes down to it where it's either going to be me or it's going to be you. And I sit there, I hold my breath, and it looks like Surgical did too. You see at the end of the match, he just exhaled it all out there at the end with his win.
That's right. With surgical precision.
With surgical
dropped
precision.
The Royal Giant to go straight for the tower, not even worried about defending that right side. Well done. I think he might have taken more damage overall, but because it was split on his two towers, he was able to get a lot more value on defense there, not having to even worry about a left side push.
Yeah.
After the minute 30 mark or so.
Yeah, that Royal Giant, like you mentioned, I mean, that is one that is almost guaranteed to hit the tower. And Cannon just not quite there as far as defense against a Royal Giant. So that really was, Senpai needed something more than that.
You know, interesting to note, someone has said this in chat, the Royal Giant deck has won 3 out of 3 times in the finals so far. We've seen Royal Giant decks from either player, and that has always been the one that's won.
Hard. He's a hard one to counter. I mean, that's you really right. have to be tactical the way you counter him. That and the Furnace. Furnace is a card that when I play against it drives me nuts just because it's something that it hinders your pushes. If you're running something like a Hog deck or something that needs to get to the tower other than a spell or a miner that goes directly in, you've got to get around it.
Certainly.
All right, here we go again. Next match. Let's see. This is our fourth match today.
Surge is ahead 2-1 over Nemsensei, but Nem has proven that he can take a win off the best.
Yes.
Can he take any more? Looks like he is playing that Furnace deck.
Golem is here.
Big old beatdown deck from Nemsensei running Furnace with Golem. Oh, Inferno Tower dropped at the front right there to try to burn through this Golem as quickly as possible. No support from Nemsensei, and that Golem is going to get burnt to a crisp.
That's the time I was talking about. Thank goodness you've got that Inferno Tower in there. When you see the Golem and you're like, okay, phew, I've got the Inferno Tower. I'm ready. Bring it on.
Surge is going to chop up these Golemites. They just get one little death explosion onto the tower.
Wow. Golem. First Golem we've seen today.
It is. Ooh, the rocket from Surge! Nukes that poor Electro Wizard. I don't think this knight's going to reach the tower, but still, very well done.
Surge likes the rocket.
Nem's going to leverage this 3 elixir advantage to continue pressuring that left lane. Drops the Furnace.
Nicely plays Musketeer there. Ooh,
wow.
See you later,
taking out with Lightning. That's how Nem's going to try to close this game out. He's got Lightning to be able to deal
with.
Lightning
versus Rocket.
Yeah. You know, Rocket is going to eventually win, so Surge has got to just play defense perfectly. Maybe throw Miners onto the tower to get some chip damage. It's up to Nem to make the big old beatdown assault with that Golem to close this game out in his favor.
I'm excited to see what else they've got in each of their decks, especially Nemsensei. He's obviously switched. He's got Golem in there. What is he going to put with that Golem for his push? I want to know.
Great question. It could be a Baby Dragon. We see a lot of Baby Dragons in Golem decks. And it could be useful now that we see these minions flying out here. Because Nemsensei's got to have something to take these flying troops out.
Yes, especially the splash from that Baby Dragon would be great.
It would indeed. Now might be a good time. There it is!
Called it!
The Baby Dragon coming out to support this Golem push on the front end.
He's probably, as soon as he saw the minions, I'm sure he was glad that he had that Baby Dragon in there as the support
expect
troop.
The Lightning. There it goes! Zaps the Inferno Tower, and the Golem
Very
is going to go straight for
Look
the Arena Tower.
Push from Nemsensei. Golem, Baby Dragon, but Surgical working hard to defend this. He's never given up.
Golemites pounding away on the tower. Nemsensei moves ahead in this game.
Starting to get another Golem already ready.
Another big push. Surge switches to
the other side.
Interesting play. Furnace, a great distraction for the Ice Golem and the minions there. Just going to suffer some damage from the Miner. But I don't think Nemsensei is too worried about that.
No, he's ignoring it for the most part. He's focusing on that push. That's what you've got to do when you're playing Golem. You've got to be willing to
Lightning
take a little bit of damage.
There it goes.
Wow.
Lightning is so strong right now with his big beatdown
in.
Decks. Ooh. Golem reaches the tower.
500.
400, and with
here
that, Nemsensei is only going to have to defend for a little bit longer before he can get that big old lightning
he's
on
got
the tower.
Lightning. Yep, that's all he needs is a lightning on the tower, and that's GG for Surgical. And I think, Surgical knows it. He drops the good game. And there it is, wow.
Thumbs up to Nemsensei. Finally, a non-Royal Giant deck wins. But
Golem.
It's a big old heavy Golem beatdown with lightning.
When you're playing in a tournament like this and you drop a Golem, you've got to know how to play Golem. And he just proved that he knows how to play. He knows how to play it well. He knows when to take damage, when to push.
That's absolutely right. And for those of you who don't know, Golem is a big old 8 elixir card, one of the most expensive in the game. If you misplay like an Ice Spirit or Skeletons or even something small like Archers, it doesn't really matter a whole lot. You know, you're going to take some damage, but it's a 3 elixir investment that you're losing there. If you misplay a Golem, though, dropping 8 elixir, you can lose an entire tower. So well done to Nemsensei there, knowing when to push and knowing when to hold off. The
high
crucial
risk,
decision making.
With that. And he took the risk and it paid off for him.
You know, in poker they say you gotta know when to hold them and when to fold them.
Yeah.
In Clash Royale it's pretty similar. You gotta know when to hold off and you gotta know when to push.
That's true.
When to stop it and when to run. And dang, Nemsensei ran in there fast with that Golem push at the end, dropping lightnings at the perfect second. You know, lightning doesn't actually kill an Inferno Tower. Yep. It does most of the damage, but the great thing about lightning is that it stuns and resets the charge. So when you're running in there with the Golem or flying, swooping in with a Lava Hound, being able to reset the damage that has built up from that Inferno Tower is absolutely critical.
Yeah, I'm interested to see now what is going to happen for this next match here. So we're tied now. We're 2-2 for each of these players. I mean, this is going to be an interesting final round here to see who takes the victory.
Now, I think that they should make them wear tutus.
If they go to a tutu draw.
Yeah.
Do a little ballerina.
Instead of a
spin.
Fifth game, we just have a ballerina. a ballet show off here.
That would be a little crown duelish.
Yeah, right, right?
Wow, tutu for tutu. I'm interested to see. I want to see what are they going to play for their last cards, for their last deck here? Are we going to see Golem again? Are we going to see Royal Giant? As we mentioned before, Royal Giant has been successful. It's been successful these rounds. It really has.
To say the least, man, Royal Giant kind of got a bad rap from tournament players. They said, it's just a card that people play on ladder because they can get it over-leveled really easily since it's a common card, and it doesn't see a whole lot of play successfully in tournaments. But, man, anyone who said that has been proven wrong here. The ESWC Finals, first three games in the Finals, wins to the Royal GG, as he's called, by some. Look at all the hype in the audience here for this fifth match between Goblin and Nemsensei.
Here we go. Looks like they've started their last match here. Here we go.
The finals.
Are we going to see
the grand finals?
Are we going to see golems, tornadoes? I don't know.
What a matchup. What are we going to see? I don't know.
This is crazy. These are good matches here.
Insane. So what are some of the big archetypes that we haven't seen yet? I know we've seen
Lava Hound.
We haven't seen Lava Hound, that's true. We have seen a lot of chip damage-based decks with Miner, though.
Yes.
A lot of Miners. Furnace once again making an appearance here. Mm-hmm. Surge is going to move in with a giant graveyard push. Oh my god, right off the bat. Soaking a Furnace, but going in with this big 10 elixir push. Minions, a fantastic response, though.
Well done
in Nemsensei. He takes a couple punches on the tower.
Now he's got set up with the counter push here.
Expect maybe a ranged troop, on the back end. Musketeer looks like,
Royal Giant to get from Nemsensei.
And the log is going to do absolutely nothing to that Royal Giant. Knocks him back just a tiny bit, but he's going to drill in hard on the left.
Surge is low elixir. He's only got a little bit right now.
I got to say, he probably did not get what he was looking for on that right side push.
No.
And Nem has moved ahead over 500 damage, or just about 500 damage, actually. Maybe he'll get it with this furnace tick over here. Yep, down to 1401 now.
Wow, so we got a giant graveyard versus a Royal Giant deck.
Decisive lead for Nem thanks to that perfect defense against the graveyard push on the right.
Electro Wizard doing some work on the left side there for Surgical. But Ice Spirit shuts him down. Not too much. Wow, looks like Surge is working to push on this left side here now. He's switching sides.
That's right. Ooh, perfect poison.
Very
it's gonna clip
nice.
All those Furnace Fire Spirits, the minions, and the tower.
He's
moving in now with the giant. Is he going to apply pressure? No, he's gonna instead defend against this Royal Giant.
Yep.
It's a very tough decision to know when you gotta, push for damage there and when you gotta defend. Surge choosing to defend there. It's going to fall a little bit behind. He's got to put this thing into overtime. He's definitely going to lose this left side tower. I don't think there's anything that he can do to keep it up with only 347 hit points left.
He's
and
gonna
over a minute
have
for Nemsensei to tick away.
Yep, he did he's going to have to just kind of forget that tower and work on his push here because he's got an expensive push. He's got the giant in the graveyard. That's a 10 elixir push. That's his combo. So he's got to invest into it
and take
a little damage.
And the dangerous thing for Surge here, once he loses the left side tower, all his back-end troops like minions...
Ooh.
Musketeer and Electro Wizard
Look
can take a
go.
Lot of damage.
Look at him, he's catching
Knight
the
just
game
directly
up,
on
just
his
like
side.
That. Leave it to Surge, catching the game right
Wonderful
back to even again.
Dropped a second too soon, though. It looks like those minions do survive.
Yes.
He's absolutely going to lose the left side tower here.
Look at that
but
push.
I'm pretty confident
nice.
That he'd be able to make the counter push. Oh, actually, the last card's a cannon. Can he defend against this RG and prevent it from reaching the tower?
Interesting.
A surprise last second card. He might actually be able to take this thing with a 1-0.
Right.
The poison is down, and all Surge needs is a log to finish that tower off.
We got 14 seconds to go. This is going to be a close match here.
Oh, no. He knows this is going to be a 2-1 game. He's going in for the counter push over on the right side. Got to roll the log in.
Yep.
There it goes. Takes the left side out.
He's going for it.
But a big, giant graveyard push on the right.
Oh, he knew he was going to take it. He started. He was ready to push in the right side tower.
Massive, giant assault.
Six.
The Musketeer is on the tower, and that looks like it's going to be the game.
Is that it?
There you go. Surgical
God!
Goblin
oh
takes
God!
The 3-2 over Nemsensei.
Oh
well done to Surge.
Oh, my God.
Jumps up. Surge got the better end of that exchange because while the Royal Giant drilled in the left side to take that King Tower, Surge said, we got tons of hit points. We don't need to worry about the King Tower. drilled over on the right side, the counter strike.
He knew that was going. He knew all he needed to do was drop the log to get that left side tower. So he went in, like you said. He knew he had to start getting that right side tower because it was going to be a battle to the death there. And he takes it.
Let's get some hammer hype in the chat. Team Netherlands and yes. Hammers Esports
Hammers
claims
Esports.
The first place in esports.
Ugh. ESWC victory from Surgical Goblin. There you have it.
Winning in Europe and in North America. Yes, Hammers has got to be the team to beat at this point. Well done to those guys. Backstab
and
Surgical Goblin winning it all.
Very nice.
On the world stage.
That is impressive. Look at that. Drop some hype, guys, in chat for Surgical
Goblin.
Oh,
man. Excellently done.
There. He just took that victory. Drop some love for
all
him.
The hammers. El yes. Drago 108 dropping the ham
yes.
hype. Good sportsmanship, says Cleve. And that's something that we got to appreciate as casters,
oh, yes.
community figures. We hope to see great sportsmanship.
Absolutely.
Handshakes, smiles all around. A 3-2 match. Could not
oh,
have gone any
yes.
closer.
Wow, look at Surgical. He feels it. I mean, that was, it looked like Nemsensei was taking that game, but Surgical really turned it around and got that comeback.
You know, holding that cannon until the very last moment
yes.
and forcing
yes.
Nemsensei to apply a big amount of elixir on that left side to make the push happen really gave Surge the advantage there. He knew that Surge knew that he was going to lose the left side tower, so rather than investing a lot of elixir on defense to get that last Royal Giant down, he just counter-pushed hard, and like we said,
yes.
you gotta know when to hold it and when to just
yes.
counter-push the opposite side and go in for the kill. Surge knew it perfectly,
yes.
played that deck flawlessly.
I think Surgical, he knew, he once it got towards the end of the game, he kind of could foresee how the ending was going to go, and so he was mentally prepared for it. And like you said, he held that cannon, so Nemsensei didn't know he had that cannon, which is kind of risky. I mean, you've got the cannon to defend against that Royal Giant, and you don't. But it works out because then Nemsensei was so not expecting it, and it allowed him to kind of turn that game around.
That's
and
right.
take the win.
Now, a lot of control decks will really try to get that 1-0 and defend heavily, you know, just keeping their towers up as long as they can while, you know, chipping on the opposite side. But big beatdown decks, like the Giant, are very happy to go for the 2-1. They say,
yeah.
you know what, you can take one of my towers out, but I can apply so much damage directly
yes.
to your tower. We're going to close it out. In my favor anyways. So we're going to get the other two competitors back up on stage. We got Ouahleouff and maybe Malcaide will make a return up here on stage. But the top three.
Yes, look at that. Surge in the middle holding his head proud as he should.
Surgical Goblin, the Netherlands player,
wow.
got second place last time, but he didn't let anyone stop him going for the gold.
No, he was determined, I think. I think he went into this with a lot of passion, a lot of drive, and he really wanted this victory.
Absolutely.
And it paid off for him.
He's surrounded now by French players. The Netherlands
yes.
representative here up on top. He's got to the left and right of him, Frenchmen, trying to hold
so
off.
True. In France, in Paris.
But
oh
the
God.
Flag of the Netherlands waving high up on top in the
yes.
center there. Well done
oh,
to Surge.
Wow.
$750 for third place, $1,250 for second.
$2,500.
Dang, $2,500 wow. for first place.
Gosh.
Surgical Goblin holding the biggest check there.
Yep.
One That's... of the biggest that we've seen in Clash Royale competitive gameplay. Holding it high
oh,
and
yeah.
waving it to the crowd.
Yeah. That's a lot of gems.
Oh, yeah, man. How many is that? 14,000 times 25. There's someone in chat, I'm sure, that can run the calculations for us there. And the trophy, of course.
Oh, yes. I'm so proud of him. He's got to feel so proud. His ham family's got to be just rooting for him, screaming, so excited. Oh, my gosh.
Pumping that trophy into the air, as he well should.
Yes, he did.
Well deserved.
Place.
Great, great win there. And that
Very
looks like
nice.
It. ESWC
Are we going to see any confetti?
Bronze and finals. Oh, yo, yeah, it's true. No confetti this
Where
time.
Where is your confetti?
We're going to get a beautiful picture of these guys
oh,
all up on top.
Yes. Wow, Surgical's family, I would hope, is so proud of him and all the hard work that he's put
Man,
in.
Man, all four of those players up on stage have a
yes.
lot to be proud of.
Yes, they do. I mean, like you had mentioned before, they did the qualifiers for this, so they went against thousands of other players to get here, so they have certainly earned their spots to be there today and to be competing and prove that they are some of the best players out there.
Sandstorm in the chat did do the numbers for us. It's 350,000 gems.
Woo!
Oh man. Now next calculation with 350,000 gems, how many super magical chests can you buy?
Wow, that's a lot.
Oh, a ton.
Gosh.
Wow.
Surge family has a gamer for a son. True.
Yep.
Very nice. Well, there you have it, guys. GG, Surgical Goblin for the win there. That was definitely no clean sweep, though. I mean, they were tied there. 2-2, Nemsensei with two wins, Surgical with two wins, and Surgical Goblin eventually taking that final one there. But I'm both of them proving that they are solid players in this game, and it was a good match.
Absolutely. Could have been Nem taking that first game that got Surge's adrenaline pumping.
Yep.
That's what you need sometimes to, at your competitive peak,
yes.
You know, have that reaction time that you need and be able to make the plans for those big pushes to close out the game. So very well done. Looks like Call of Duty is going to be coming up next ESWC.
Well, thank you guys so much for tuning in with us this morning to watch the finals and see who took the victory. Congratulations to Surgical Goblin and Hammers Esports for taking that victory. And congrats to all of our other finalists as well, Nemsensei, Ouahleouff, and Malcaide. For making the final four there.
Very, very well done. You know, gotta give a shout out also to Team Vitality coming in second place and, you know, representing one of the best competitive groups in the world. Thank you so much, guys, for tuning in. I had a blast casting with you.
Same, Woody.
BBXH.
Absolutely. We always have a good time. This is our third casting together. Go team. And who knows where Woody and I will be next, but of course, make sure that you follow both of us on Twitter. He is at Woody_CR on Twitter, and I am just BBXH_Twitch on Twitter, so make sure that you drop us a follow. And both of us are streamers, obviously. We're on my channel, but Woody is a Clash Royale streamer
Woody
as well.
WWoody123, yeah. Thank you very much for inviting me on your channel. It was an absolute pleasure. You know, you guys do a wonderful job setting up the overlay and getting all the tech things built up for me.
Yes.
Big shout out to Someone XH for doing all the hard work on the back end to make our stream look
beautiful. Overlays and all this good stuff. Crawling underneath the desk to switch
Did they catch him? Did they catch him on the bottom down there? That's why he had to put out this overlay that covers the bottom of the screen so they could see him. Yeah. Also, huge thanks to ESWC and the Clash Royale team for being able to set us up as the official English commentators for the bronze
so
and finals match. Those guys are absolutely awesome. Big shout out to them.
And the in-app shout out from the Supercell Clash Royale. Thank you guys so much. We love you guys. Thank you for your support and helping the community turn Clash Royale into an esports. We love this game so much. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. And we will see you all next time. Have a great day, you guys.
See you around. Have a good one.
Bye.